turn to 197. 197. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness seems to hide his face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. His oath, his covenant, his blood support me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, he then is all my hope and stay. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. If it's okay, let's get 207. 207. On the mountain top appearing, lo, the sacred herald sends welcome news to Zion fairy, Zion longing hostile lands. Mourning captive, God himself will lose thy bands. Mourning captive, God himself will lose thy bands. Has thy night been long and mournful? Have thy friends unfaithful proved? Have thy foes been proud and scornful? By thy sights and tears unmoved, cease thy mourning, Zion still is well beloved. Cease thy mourning, Zion still is well beloved. God thy God will now restore thee, he himself appears thy friend. All thy foes shall flee before thee, hear their boast and cry on sin. Great deliverer, Great deliverance, thy king will surely send. Peace and joy shall now attend thee, all thy warfare's now be past. God thy Savior will defend thee, victorious thine at last. All thy conflicts in the everlasting rest. All thy conflicts in the everlasting rest.
Anyone else have a number?
Three.
208. Number 208.
I need thee, O Lord.
95. 95. My dearest friends and minds above, our hearts in sweetest union grew. Your friendship's like a drawing band, yet we must take the parting hand. Your
see your screen.
Number 559.
$5.59. $5.59.
My Jesus, blessed Jesus, what a grand and gracious thing. Oh, the precious name of Jesus, what a bright and brilliant beam. Oh,
number 556. time number?
444.
Yeah.
Good morning again. Good to see each one of you this morning. We certainly are thankful to the Lord for this opportunity, this time that we've set aside to come and join ourselves together in worship, to offer up sacrifice to the Lord with the words that we would extend and the things that we would think and the things that we would feel. I certainly hope and trust that each one has prayed for this worship service as we come together and this time hear about Jesus, sing about Jesus, pray to him, and rejoice in him. We certainly are thankful for him. We have so much to be thankful for. We have a long list of things that we ask the Lord to help us with, and we should. There's no doubt. But we have certainly a long list of things that we are blessed to see that we are thankful for in Jesus Christ. Hallelujah, what a Savior. Jesus Christ, what a friend we have in Jesus. So as we join here together this morning, we're thankful for our song service that we have been able to worship in. We are thankful to the Lord once more for our song leaders. I hope in your prayer life that you are not just thankful for the song service, you remember them at the end of every song service that we sing, but you think about them in prayer as we live here in this earth, as well as each member and that composes this body and friends that come our way to worship with us. So as we go to the Lord in prayer this morning, there's several that we want to try to remember as we bow before the Lord. Sister Wanda is looking to go home today, so we hope and trust that her trip will be light and that she will be okay at home. I think Beth asked her if she was doing all right, and she said that she's as rehabbed as she can get. So we pray the Lord's blessing in her trip home as well as her continued recovery. We continue to remember her son, Dwayne, and pray the Lord's blessing upon him, Brother Gene, and Sister Jewel, and Sister Ruth, Sister Virginia. We pray the Lord's continued blessing upon them. We know that Sister Virginia went to the doctor this week, got some treatment, and seemed to help her breathing pretty much immediately. So we're thankful to the Lord for that. We ask the Lord's continued watch care over her. Robert, Sister Ruth's brother, we continue to be in prayer for him. Andrew May continues to recover well. We're thankful to God for that. We ask the Lord's continued blessing upon him. Casey and her upcoming delivery could be this month. We'll see. We hope and trust the Lord would continue to bless her. Brother Brad and Brother Josh, Sister Cassie and their engagements. We continue to thank the Weatherby family, Brother Tim's co-workers. We pray the Lord's continued blessing upon them. Brother Gene said that Donna Burris is at Northeast Hospital now. She's pretty low, so we ask the Lord's watch care over her. Clyde Pickler, Teresa Long, Karen Smith, we pray the Lord's continued blessing upon them, as well as Daryl Klutz. We want to remember Elder Utz and Elder Huckabee and Elder Holder. We pray the Lord's continued watch care over them. Brother Gene let me know that Brother Josh and Chelsea both tested positive for COVID, so we pray that that would be light with them the Lord would bless in their healing and recovery. A few from No Creek, if we could mention, continue. We're thankful for Sister Merlin and her health. We ask the Lord's continued watch care over her, Angie, and her healing of her broken leg. Sister Bennett and Sister Lib, Mary Catherine and Carol, the Eatons and the Dunns. So we ask the Lord's blessing upon them. We pray the Lord's blessing upon this country. We beg the Lord that he'd continue to bless us with his grace and his mercy, that he would strengthen, that he would bless the leaders, that he would continue to strengthen this kingdom in which we are part of today, that we would not be discouraged, but continue to be encouraged. And we should be encouraged when we think of Jesus Christ, our King of our kingdom. He was not discouraged, and he did not fail. And in that, we should be encouraged. Feels good to be bought with the blood of Jesus Christ, doesn't it? That we are not our own, that we are his.
It's a refreshing feeling.
We ask the Lord's continued blessing upon us, this kingdom, here in particular at Meadow Creek. Our military, we're thankful for them. We pray the Lord's continued blessing upon them. Our first responders and our deacons that serve here. Ask the Lord's continued blessing. We pray that the Lord would bless us today as we worship, with a stirring up of the Spirit. Is there anyone else we'd like to call out? Okay. No one else being called out. We'd like to stand and sing a hymn as a way of opening and ask Brother Kevin if he'd come forward and have prayer, public prayer, remember him in prayer, and each one of us as we stand and sing. Brother Gene, what number?
296.
Number 296.
Here in the vineyard of my Lord, I love to live and labor, and be obedient to my God until my dying hour.
We say. Sanctify, Lord, as we bow before thee this day, as we come together as brothers and sisters in Christ, we can present our bodies a living sacrifice into the kingdom that thou hast established on earth. That we can come in out of the world, we can come into this place, we'd be found singing the songs of Zion, singing praises unto thy great name. We know, Lord, that thou hast promised where there are two or three gathered in thy name, that thou will be in the midst. We thank thee, Lord, that we've even felt thy presence this day through the service of song and hymn, that we can lift our voices, we can feel closer unto thee, and we can draw nigh. Thou would draw nigh unto us. We thank thee, Lord, for this time together, and we ask, Lord, that thou would be with us. We know, Lord, that it's a new day, it's a new time. Help us, Lord, that we could be able to worship thee in an acceptable way, acceptable manner. We pray, Lord, for the service that's yet to come. We ask, Lord, that thou would bless Brother Eddie as he's to come before us, as he is to stand. Is to bring forth the good news of the gospel, that is about our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We know that he is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He reigns and rules over his dominion today, seated at the right hand of the Father, making intercessions. Lord, we pray unto thee that thou would hear our people cry, that thou would look down upon us and show mercy. We know we're unworthy, sinful creatures, but yet, Lord, thou hast saved thy family and thy people, we all be elect. We know, Lord, that if there's any righteousness within us, it's been placed there through thy work,
amen,
and the work of the Holy Ghost, and thou hast softened our stony heart, given us a hard flesh. We could love, that we could treat our fellow man and our fellow brother with kindness. We thank thee, Lord, that thou hast given us that within us. But we know, Lord, there's much that our human nature, our sinful nature is contrary to that. We know there's a great warfare within us. We fight and we struggle daily. We pray, Lord, that thou would help us to strengthen the inner man, that it might overcome those sinful desires and lusts of the human nature. We could suppress that. We can somehow walk closer to our brothers and sisters in Christ. We thank thee, Lord, for this little band of people here today. We ask, Lord, that thou would be with each one. We know, Lord, thou knowest every ailment. Thou knowest all about us. Thou knowest our down sittings and our downfalls. We pray, Lord, that thou would help us, to give us strength that we could overcome. That we could be living our lives in a way that would be honorable in some way before thee. We know, Lord, there's much sin all around and in our lives. We pray, Lord, that thou would help us to do what we need to do, that we could honor thy great name. We could hold up that blood-stained banner of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We thank thee, Lord, that thou hast given us the knowledge of the truth as it is in Christ Jesus, that we could know thy people, that their destiny is secure. We know, Lord, that thou hast made a way, thou hast made it possible for a sinful man that one day, after this life is over, even though we'd be dead for 10,000 years, whatever the time may be, we know, Lord, that thou hast will come, and I will collect up thy people, and they'll be resurrected and changed into a glorified body that will be like it, fashioned unto thy glorified body. We'll be heirs and joint heirs of Jesus Christ before the Father. We thank thee for that promise, that hope that lies within us. We ask, Lord, that thou would strengthen and embolden us in that hope. We might be able to worship thee appropriately. We thank you, Lord, for those that we've heard called out today. We ask, Lord, we pray for each case. We know that there's much sickness in our in the body here and in other places that we try to remember and call out their names. That might be that we would lift them up in prayer, Lord, that Thou would hear our plea, that Thou would intervene and help them along the way. We pray the same for ourselves, Lord, that would give us strength and help us. We thank Thee for the help and strength that we do have. We know, Lord, that that's a gift from Thee. We pray, Lord, that for our country and the land in which we live, we pray, Lord, that Thou would grant us the capacity to live peaceably with all men, that we might see those that govern around us and above us, that we might see them, Lord, turn unto Thee, that our nation as a whole would forsake those simple things that so easily beset us. We could be found following closer unto Thee, and that governing the laws that govern this land would align with the precepts and things of Thy word and Thy gospel. We pray for that end, Lord. We ask, Lord, that Thou would go with us. We pray, Lord, that Thou would lead us and guide us to the purpose of this service. Again, we pray for Brother Eddie as he's coming for us. Lift him up. Give him strength through Thy power. It's in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, we ask all these blessings in His name. Amen. Amen.
Thankful for the prayer that's been offered up, and I hope and trust that you'll continue to pray as I stand before you this morning and try to we hope and trust the Lord would bless the things that I believe that He's placed upon my mind. If you have your Bibles, let's open up to the book of Romans. Go to the book of Romans. We'd like to read a few scriptures and beg the Lord's blessings upon them. Romans chapter 6. Romans chapter 6, we'll start at verse 15 and read several verses. Romans 6:15. What then? Shall we sin because we are not under the law, but under grace? God forbid. Know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey, his servants ye are to whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death, or of obedience unto righteousness? But God be thanked, that ye were servants of sin, but ye have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered you, being made free from sin, ye became the servants of righteousness. I speak after the manner of men because of the infirmity of your flesh. For as ye have yielded your members servants to uncleanness and to iniquity unto iniquity, even so now yield your members servants to righteousness unto holiness. Excuse me. Kind of slipped out. So we'd like to see what the Apostle Paul was trying to express to the Romans. Now, I want us to have an understanding of this. The Apostle Paul desired in his heart that the children, God's people, would be obedient. That God's people would not just be obedient, but they would serve the Lord with all of their heart, and that they would want to serve the Lord because it is the right thing to do. Does that make sense? So his desire for these people that he's writing to was wanting to stir them up that they would have a zeal of service to the Lord because they choose to serve the Lord. And that is the right thing to do because God has commanded them to serve the Lord. What other reason should the children of God have to serve the Lord than the Lord has said, serve me? The church at Rome, in which this letter was addressed, written by the Apostle Paul, was made up, I think, of Jews and non-Jews, Jews and Gentiles. But the Apostle Paul, in the beginning of the writings of this letter, was, and I'll take the words from Brother Kevin, brothers and sisters in Christ, no longer is there a division in the sight of God, of God's elect, as he taught about the doctrines of grace and mercy. There's not a division among Jew and Gentile. And another way of saying that, there's not a division among Jew and all the other nations of the world, because you were either Jew or somebody else. So there's not a division among that anymore. And he wanted to, in the, I think it's the third chapter, at the end of the second chapter, it says, but for he is not a Jew, which is one outwardly, 2:28, neither is that circumcision which is outward in the flesh, but he is a Jew, he is this child of God, he is of the elect family of God, not because you're born of the seed of Abraham, not because you have anything of this outward flesh, whether you're of circumcision or you can look back in the rolls of the history of every Israelite and say, I was born of the seed of Abraham. I'm a child of God because he was chosen. Abraham was chosen. He's the father of the faithful. The Apostle Paul says, that's not the reason you're a child of God. The reason that you're a child of God is that he is not a Jew, which is one inwardly, outwardly, but he is a Jew, which is one inwardly. And the circumcision is of that of the heart, not of the flesh. In the spirit and not in the letter. Now that, see, that's getting to the, let's get into the, you know, we serve in the spirit, not in the letter. Whose praise is not of men, but of God. Does that make sense? So he's writing to the children, not according to the flesh, but according to the spirit. And I suppose the purpose I'm getting to here is a lot of times it can be tricky as we read and study the Bible. I'm not that God's trying to trick us. But if we keep this in mind that the Apostle Paul is writing to those that have been circumcised in the heart, which is another way of saying being born again of the Spirit. So Paul is not writing so they can be born of the Spirit. Paul is writing so that they can love and serve God because they are born of the Spirit. Does that make sense? That's very critical in the understanding of the Apostle Paul's writings. He's not saying, I'm going to make you a child of God so you can go to heaven and be in glory. He's saying, God has made you a child of God. Jesus Christ died for you and is resurrected, and you're going to glory. So while you are at home in this flesh, serve the Lord, not according to the letter, but according to the Spirit, and serve him with your heart. Because God requires that service. And it's not to the praise of men. Notice this, but it's to the praise of God. Okay, so now let's get back to chapter 6. So the Apostle Paul is trying to stir up these Romans in the 17th chapter, but God be thanked, there's a comma, like a parenthesis. Although you were the servants of sin, of course, the Apostle Paul is not thanking God that they were the servants of sin, but he was saying, God be thanked, although you were the servants of sin, but now, ye have obeyed from the heart. So there's two words that I hope the Lord is directing me in this. And that is the heart and doctrine. Serve from the heart. Serve from the heart. Have an understanding of the word heart as the Bible expresses it. There's different applications of the word heart. As I was praying and meditating about speaking and pray the Lord's blessing, and is this of the Lord? And then when you hear Brother Kevin pray and you hear him talk about how God has given us a heart of flesh that we can feel and that we can love, I have to think that God is in the matter. I believe that the Bible, in the Old Testament as well as New Testament, shows us that the heart is the seat or the fountain of life. Of course, we have a natural heart. And I would like to spend a minute just to express to you how we can see that our natural heart is kind of, in a sense, the source, the maintenance, the fountain of our life. If your heart stops beating, what will happen? Will you have life? The heart is a muscular organ. I love speaking about this, and I tried to bring up some of this at No Creek last week because it's just amazing. Of the creation, you know, when we think of we are God's, you know, he created man on the sixth day, and we see a man standing up, man, women, that humankind. But do you stop to think just a moment about all the millions and zillions of parts that is in this body, composing and making up this body that God created? You know, I was listening to Elder Holder recently, and he made a very good comment. You know, he said people struggle sometimes with God creating the world in 6 24-hour days. His thought was, he don't really think it took God 6 24-hour days. It was just like the first day was 24 hours, and he spoke it, and it was done. So it might have been like a millisecond that it took God to create it, but it was in that first day was 24 hours, second day was 24 hours. So there it is. Our heart, your heart is about the size of your fist. Your heart. A few statistics, I like this. Your natural heart says the average person's heart beats about 72 times a minute. Your pulse rate, check that, you can see. Yours might be faster. Mine's usually slower. But think about that. Now, what God put in you, this heart. You're born with a heart. 72 times a minute. There's 1,440 minutes in a day. So do you have any idea? Here's a little math problem for you. 72 times 1,440. 100,680 times a day, your heart is pumping. Do you see how that's the fountain? That's where you get your life from, in the sense that it's pumping blood, oxygen, nutrient, blood to every part of your body. If you think that's staggering, now just think about this. You know, remember when Adam was created? His body was not corrupted. It wasn't like he was ending right then. It wasn't until he was ending until he sinned. Does that make sense? So that heart that God put in him would just keep pumping, 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 pumping. So 103,000 times a day, 37,843,200 times a year. We'll round it up just to make your math a little easier. 40 million heartbeats a year. Can you imagine that? This muscular organ, do you see how it's... So I put that in, 40 million times 60. My calculator said, duh. It's like, times 10 to the... Isn't it just amazing how God has made this body? Is there, could you think of any scientist, any theologian, any man in the world that could build something, not even with a battery? It's not plugged in, it is just made, it's in your body, and it's pumping 40 million times a year. You think anybody can make that? And now they try to, thank God for, you know, medical. I'm not criticizing them at all. You know, the kidney and all its special functions, these medical doctors can simulate the function of a kidney, but it's bigger than the size of this. How big is your kidney? That big? Something like that. God's a genius, isn't he? So the point of all of this is I want you to see that this natural heart is kind of like the center of our physical, I mean, it's the fountain of this physical life. It controls, I mean, without it, it ceases to exist. Now, along with this natural heart, that keeps this body physically going, I think man is born with another heart. He's born with a natural heart, that where his thoughts and emotions come from. Not this muscular organ heart, but this natural heart. And this natural heart, Did you see the difference? As a matter of fact, Ezekiel, I believe, calls it a heart of stone. I think Brother Kevin mentioned that in his prayer, the stony heart. So man is born with a stony heart, not this physical 40 million times beaten heart, but a stony heart. And this stony heart in which a man is born with is not friendly to God. It's where all of his thoughts, desires, and emotions, and wills, and everything comes from that he does, I think, in this life, that heart. It's the center, just like our physical hearts pumping and giving us, sustaining this life. So is this stony heart, in the sense
that the natural man gets his thoughts and emotions from it. Does that make sense? And that heart, that stony heart, says that there is no God. Psalms chapter 14, verse 1, what does it say? The fool has said in his heart, this is the stony heart. The fool has said in his heart that there is no God. There is a God. So there's fools that have a stony heart that say that there is no God. In Genesis chapter 6, notice this about the thoughts of the stony heart or the heart of stone. chapter 6. And God, Genesis chapter 6, verse 5. And God saw that the wickedness of man was very great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. There was no thought of God in this heart of stone. You know what Jesus says? In Matthew chapter 9, he says, and he entered into a ship and passed over and came into his own city. Matthew chapter 9, verse 1. And behold, they brought to him a man sick of the palsy, lying on a bed. And Jesus, seeing their faith, said unto the sick of the palsy, Son, be of good cheer, thy sins be forgiven thee. And behold, certain of the scribes said within themselves, this man blasphemeth. And Jesus, knowing their thoughts, said, wherefore think ye evil in your hearts? And the other, in Matthew, let's see. In Matthew chapter 15. Do you not understand, 15:17, do you not understand that whatsoever entereth in at the mouth goeth into the belly and is cast out into the drought? But those things which proceed out of the mouth come forth from the heart, and they defile the man. This stony heart, Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 9, you know that scripture. This is the heart of stone. The heart of stone. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? I, the Lord, search the heart. I try the reins, even to give every man according to his ways and according to the fruit of his doing. So do you get the sense of this heart of stone, or this stony heart, which cannot serve God? Because at the very beginning, he says, there is no God. So how can I serve a God in which I do not believe? The things that proceed out of the heart, out of the mouth, come from the heart. Speaking evil comes from an evil heart, comes from this stone, heart of stone. Does that make sense? But I want us to notice this. But the Apostle Paul says, God be thanked, ye have obeyed from the heart. Now that's kind of contrary, don't you think? Ye have obeyed of the words of the Apostle Paul, ye have obeyed the gospel from the heart, when the heart says that there is no God, and the heart says there's only evil imagination continually, none of their thoughts are of God. How can the heart serve God? Well, guess what he's done? Guess what God has done? God has given you a new heart. You know, in Philippian letter, it says, it is God that worketh in you both to will. You have the will to serve God. It is God that worketh in you both to will and to do his good pleasure. God be thanked. And that's Ezekiel chapter 11. Let's go there. And I want us to read about this circumcision of the heart. In Ezekiel chapter 11, as well as in 36, in verse 19, in Ezekiel 11, it says, "And I," this is the Lord, this is God. You remember when they asked Jesus, the scribes were trying to trick him up, and they said, "Well, what's the greatest law?" You remember what Jesus says? "Serve the Lord your God with all your heart." That's what's required. So, dearly beloved, this is what God has given you to serve the Lord with your heart. "And I will give them one heart, and I will put a new spirit within them, and I will take away the stony heart out of their flesh and give them a heart of flesh." So I want us to see that we cannot believe without the heart in which we have been implanted with in the new birth, being born again of the Spirit. We get a new heart. When we're born of the flesh, we get a heart. When we're born of the Spirit, we get a heart of flesh. We get a fleshly heart, a heart of the Spirit. And just like that stony heart, you remember Jesus says, out of the heart proceedeth the thoughts. You got an evil heart, gonna have evil thoughts. You got a pure heart, you can have pure thoughts. Out of the heart, where the heart is, there's also is the man's treasures. So, without this new, pure heart given to us as a gift from God in the new birth, claiming this flesh, we are then able to serve the Lord with our heart. Not the letter, but with the heart. You know, giving is based upon this new heart. 2 Corinthians chapter 11. Let's look at this. Believing, giving. 2 Corinthians 9. 2 Corinthians 9, I believe it is. So the Apostle Paul is writing to the Romans that you have been given this new heart. Serve the Lord your God out of goodness, out of love, not out of necessity, not out of the law, but because God has loved you and you love God, serve him. Now, I believe that the New Testament church, and I believe this is supported in the form of doctrine given by the apostles. We're not under the law of tithing, however you want to interpret that. Not under a law given by Moses that we should give and how much we should give. We're not under that law. Remember, we're not to serve according to the letter, which is the law, but the Spirit. For example, if you were required to give 10% of all of your wealth, you would be giving, and if you were obedient to that, you're obedient, but you're not, believe it or not, you're not fulfilling the worship in which the Lord God requires of you. Does that make sense? Even though you might, well, that's a man's law. Well, let's just read the scripture. I hope not to confuse you. But this I say, this is 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 6. But this I say, he which soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly, and he which soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully. Every man according as he has purposeth in his heart, so let him give. Pastor, how much should I give? You should give whatever you have purposed in your heart. What if it's not enough? Well, you should give whatever's purposed in your heart. What if it's too much? You should give it whatever's purposed in your heart. God does not appreciate, God does not love one that gives out of the letter of the law, but he loves, as it says, for God loveth a cheerful giver. That is, God is praising that worship. God loveth a cheerful giver. He's not giving out of necessity. I had a good friend, said he likes to give at church because how he's kind of figured it out in his mind, if he gives like $20 usually during the week, he's getting $20 back somewhere. He has it purposed in his heart. It's like he's playing the stock market with the kingdom of God. That's not giving as a cheerful giving. That's giving out of the desires of the flesh and the lust of the flesh. To make money in this world, I'll give to the kingdom of God. That's blasphemy. That's not what God says. God says you purpose it in your heart. It was a widow woman. She purposed it in her heart. By the ways of the world, it was like she shouldn't even have given what she gave. But you know what? She gave all that she had. She purposed it in her heart. I believe that she was a cheerful giver. She went away and she did. If she gave all that she had, she went away with nothing. And yet, God loveth a cheerful giver. In Romans, so it takes this heart that God has given us that we can be obedient in giving. In Romans chapter 10, I want us to see that it takes this new heart that God's born you again with, to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Now remember, this is the same book of Romans that the Apostle Paul is writing to in the 6th chapter as he is in the 10th chapter. Remember, he's not writing to them to say, if you will do this, then you get into heaven. He's saying you should do this because Christ has purchased you and you are going to glory one day. We have an understanding that we can't promote Jesus Christ. We can't say Christ died for our sins with the stony heart, but we can with the heart of flesh in which he's given us in regeneration. Do you see the difference? Because if you understand that difference, then you can rightly divide this portion of Scripture. Because it does say, if you confess the Lord with thy mouth, then thou shalt be saved. Is that true? Absolutely, it's true. But I say you're saving yourselves in this world, and you're saving yourselves into an obedient worship of Jesus Christ, an obedient worship service of God, presenting your body a living sacrifice. Oh, well, let's start at chapter 1, verse 1, chapter 10. Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. That's true. But remember, the Apostle Paul believed in the salvation that we have in Jesus Christ. Yet he said, Israel, children of Israel, forget about your self-righteousness, submit, believe, accept the righteousness which is of God. Then you will be free in this world from the self-condemnation, from the guilty conscience. For I bear them record that they have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge. For they being ignorant of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. For Christ is the end of law for righteousness. And we go down to verse number eight. I want us to notice this. But what saith it? The word is nigh in thee, even in thy mouth, notice this, and in thy heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. So the Apostle Paul is telling them that you have this heart in which God has given you. The word is in you by faith. The circumcision of the heart, not made with hands. That if thou shalt confess with the mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart. Now, can the heart of stone believe in the Lord Jesus? But with the mouth is only going to confess what the heart believeth in. You see the necessity of having this new heart in order to confess that you have a risen, returning Savior, Jesus Christ? For if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. With the heart we believe in the righteousness of God. So you see, if we don't have this new heart in which Ezekiel is speaking of, we're not able to please God. We're not able to please God in worship if we have not this heart. And if we're not doing it according to the spirit and not the letter. And back in Romans chapter 6. And there's other examples of the heart, but we'll move ahead. I want us to see this. You were servants of sin, but ye have obeyed from the heart, Romans 6, 17. That form of doctrine which was delivered to you, being made free from sin, being made free from sin, ye became the servants of righteousness. Now he says this. I speak after the manner of men because of the infirmity of your flesh. He's talking to these church people. For as ye have yielded your members, servants to uncleanness, and to iniquity, he's saying this. I believe this is it. You in this flesh, ye have chosen to sin and to be sinful and to live that lifestyle. You've chosen that. And then he goes on to say, now that you are no longer servants to sin, but servants unto righteousness, choose to serve righteousness. Does that make sense? Do you see the comparison that he's making? Man in the flesh, That stony heart wills him to choose. This spiritual heart wills him to serve the Lord in righteousness. Think of it this way. Joshua chapter 24. Choose you this day whom ye will serve. Be the servants of sin, the servants of righteousness, out of a desire to serve the Lord Jesus Christ with all of your heart and soul and strength and mind. Joshua is saying to the children of Israel, remember, Joshua is not trying to make children of Israel. They're already of the nation of Israel. But he says to them, choose you this day whom you will serve. And I believe that's how the Apostle Paul is trying to present this to the Romans in chapter 6. Ye have been bought with a price. God has delivered you. God has delivered you. There is no condemnation upon you. Ye are free from every sin, from every iniquity, from every transgression. Ye are kept by the power of God. Serve him in love. Because that's right. Not that, and you know, I've experienced this, and you may have too. Serving begets serving. Giving begets giving. Studying begets studying. Now, what does that mean? I think this is what this means. The more you serve, the more you want to serve. Try it. Prove me wrong. The more you read and study, the more you want to read and study. The more you give, the more you want to give. It is God in you. It's God in you working to will and to do his good pleasure in the service of the kingdom. Serve with the heart in which you have been given in regeneration, which is opposite of this stony heart, which has been removed. Because it's still in there. We still have fleshly tendencies. But God has given us this heart, this fleshy heart that we can respond in spirit, respond in spiritual things. Aren't you thankful for that? So, let us Master, in Matthew chapter 22, verse 36, Master, 22, 36, Matthew, this is what Jesus says. You remember that rich young ruler that went away sorrowful? He wouldn't want to serve according to the rules of Christ there. Master, which is the great commandment in the law? And Jesus said unto him, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. May God add his blessing. May we rejoice, and may we desire to serve the Lord, because he has served. He was a servant. He was the greatest servant of all. He laid down his life, and there is no greater love than a man that would lay down his life for his friends, that he may take it again. And in laying down his life, he redeemed you. He purchased you. You are his property. You are his property. We publish the doors of the church open for the reception of members. As we stand and sing a hymn, what number, Brother Gene?
472.
472.
I have a lot of friends, so true and kind. I count them more and more each day. But one above them all, I always find. So close to my soul, the Savior. I meet him on the time of sore distress, and when the light is on to see. So the light to
to stay with us in talking this afternoon about the conference. I mean, the association. Is that this afternoon?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Be out to lunch for having discussions about the conference and hosting or the association. Sorry about that. Any other announcements?
I'd like to mention Liberty Hills Communion next weekend.
This upcoming weekend?
Is that right?
Okay.
Dr. Ben Winsor will be with them Friday night. They have communion Saturday night. I'm not sure if he'll be here Sunday or not.
Okay, so either Friday and Saturday, their communion service Saturday. Be in prayer for that. Yeah. Any other announcements? We have a we have a meeting this Wednesday evening. Well, the park's supposed to be with us next Sunday night. So we'll be in prayer for that. Okay. And we have such opportunity. Thank God for that. Anything else? Come on, if you'll close with prayer.
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank Thee for this day, and we can certainly thank Thee for the time we got to spend in Thy house this morning. And Father, we thank Thee for the message that's gone up before us. We ask that Thou would watch over us and guide us, and may we meditate on those things we've heard today. Father, we ask that Thou would go with us as we go our separate ways, and ask for Thy guidance, and may all that we say and do be to Thy honor and glory. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Thank you.